watched previously, welcome back. I know it's been a long time. I chatted about these karting videos 6 months ago, and you know, the year has just gotten away from us. It's gotten pretty crazy with karting, and things have kind of gotten out of hand. What went from a season of practice and having fun has turned into a season of competing and having fun. So I haven't had a lot of time, but in the prep for Super Nats, which is 2 weeks away, I have a new chassis here that I have to build. So I figured I might as well show you guys kind of my procedure and what I do to put a chassis together and prep for an event like Super Nats. In the background is Tiffany's cart, which is the exact same chassis. These are a GFC GT14. Their only shifter chassis that they offer. This kind of came about after testing a day with Reggie Brown and his dad in R3 Speed Fab. We went and did a test on the chassis and really liked it. After putting Tiffany in it and, you know, some of the problems that she was having in some of our other chassis, she wasn't having in this one. It just worked really well for her. I liked the feel of it, and here we are. So, yeah, I got to give a shout out to Reggie and his dad. And R3 Speed Fab, they've kind of taken care of us and gotten us where we are with these chassis and have been great help. So, I mean, if you guys need a GFC chassis, parts, whatever, especially if you're in the Midwest, reach out to them. They also do chassis work and, you know, they have fixed countless frames that we have, you know, crashed into things and whatever. It's kind of a consumable, to be honest. But today, I'm going to start by getting the axle put in, getting the bearings aligned, kind of getting everything on the rear end straight and perfect, and I'm going to show you guys the way that I do it. Now, there's a million ways to do everything on one of these carts. Everybody will tell you something different. This is just the way that I do it. So don't feel obligated that, you know, this is the way you have to do it, or if someone tells you that's wrong, you know, everyone has their opinion. This is just the way that I do it. I'm probably overly picky with how some of this stuff is done, but I come from a machining background, so I'm kind of picky with that kind of stuff. But you know, I'm not gonna get too crazy in depth, but show you guys kind of the basics. And you know, if you guys have questions about, you know, more in depth things, leave them in the comments, and we can go through them. But the main thing here is, you know, when you buy a chassis, whether you buy a chassis new or you buy a chassis used, for me, I think that it is imperative that you tear the chassis down to nearly bare frame like I have here and put it together. I mean, obviously the level of competition that you're doing has a lot to do with how particular and how complex you want to get. But I think with the price of tires and fuel and everything else, I think going to an event and losing or not finishing because of mechanical failure is not really an option. I think we all agree that this stuff costs a lot of money, and if you're gonna do it, you know, go there with the best equipment that you can afford to have, and know that it's in good shape. You know, I hate seeing people not finish a race because of a mechanical problem. So like I said, this is a new chassis, but this would be no different if you bought a used chassis. You know, if you buy a used chassis, tear the thing down, pull the axle out, pull the carriers out, and assemble it from scratch so you know what you have. You can't trust the person before you that they have done it perfect. You need to verify yourself. So let's begin. We'll talk a little bit here about the rear end, about the axle, about these carrier bearings. There is a lot to this. There is a lot that can be wrong, and a lot that really pays a price if it's not correct. So these shifter carts, and almost all shifter carts at this point, run a 50 millimeter rear axle. Some of the tags, LO206, I think the 50 mil is fairly common. There are still some 40 and even 30 mils out there, but 50 mil is what you're usually going to see. They run, on the shifter chassis, they run three bearing carriers, and you know, it's imperative that all three of these are in line with each other and running perfectly true so that the bearing's not bound up and the axle spins free. You know, I remember when I first started, it seemed kind of crazy to think that, you know, a bearing with a little bit of drag is going to make that big of a difference on a 50 horsepower shifter engine. But when you have 40, 50 horsepower shifter engines and your cart has a bearing that's a little bit bound up than the guy next to you, you lose. So it is important. So talking about these bearings, the way these bearings go into this housing is the outside of the bearing is actually round. So the bearing actually slips through these two openings. You put it in there sideways and then you spin it into position. So if you look closely at the top here, you can kind of see that the top of this, you can see the bearing and the top of the bearing, outside of the bearing is round. And so what that allows you to do is that allows you to have misalignment in this bracket. When this carrier or this cassette is bolted into the chassis, it's bolted in true to whatever, however they were welded in, right? It's not exactly perfect, and that's why the bearing allows you to have a misalignment so that you can make sure that it fits right. So I always take these out. If it's a used chassis, clean them, whatever. You know, if the bearing doesn't spin free, if the bearing seems like it's notchy or it's got gravel in it, replace it. They're not super cheap, but it's way easier to replace it when you're at this point than to tear the car all the way back down and start over. So I always tear these out, clean them up. There's a bolt in a different spot on every cart that is the pinch bolt that locks this bearing into this cassette. I loosen those up. That way we can kind of make sure that this is perfectly aligned in this cassette and perfectly aligned with the other two bearings in our cart. So the first thing you want to do is take your, if you're on a shifter chassis or you're on a chassis with a third bearing, take the third bearing out. The bearing that goes here, take it out, set it aside. That's going to be last. All right. So you have your two outside bearings. I will always pick what I want for ride height. A lot of that is determined by what kind of events you do, where you're racing. You know, here in the Midwest, if we're racing on our sprint tracks, they're not super smooth. So, you know, I don't want the bottom of the chassis to get tore up. So I'll typically set the chassis high and the axle low so that the chassis doesn't grind on the ground. Going to an event like Supernats, the chassis is kind of a throwaway in my opinion. For what it costs to go to an event like that, I don't care. I want the chassis to perform at its best. If that means we burn through a chassis in a weekend, but we can pick up a few positions by being, you know, by doing that, then that's what we're going to do. So I'm going to set this in the middle, not exactly knowing what the track layout's going to be, and having never driven a Supernats before, I'm going to set the rear bearing carrier in the middle. On this chassis, there are three holes. That give you basically three options. Some other chassis, CRG and a few others, have a slot and like an unlimited amount of options. You know, on a CRG, you can even set the bearing carrier forward or backwards to change your overall wheelbase. But there are small holes that you can use to put a pin in to make sure that the two bearings on the outside are the same. Obviously, these holes are just plasma cut out, drilled out, whatever, so they're not perfect. So, you know, keep that in mind. But I also think that, you know, putting the axle into the chassis, you know, whether one bearing is, you know, 30 thousandths higher than the other, I think that that's minimal. But I do the best to put the bolts in and check where the bearing is with a digital caliper, or, you know, if all you have is a tape measure, just put a tape measure on it. At least make sure that on a tape measure it looks the same. You know, get as close as you can. Something else to keep in mind too is these bearings, one side has a flange and one side does not. So every manufacturer kind of has a recommendation too. Us working with Gary, Gary is someone who's been around who knows what's going on. And most chassis manufacturers, if you talk to the right person, somebody knows how it should be set up. The way that we're going to do it is we're going to put the flange in. But I can't tell you how many carts I have bought used that the flange on one side is facing in and the flange on the other side is facing out. And all this does is this adds rigidity to the axle. So you got one side of the axle that has a, you know, 3/4 to 1 inch, you know, extra rigid collar to it, and the other side doesn't. So the axle in all reality on each side is not gonna be the same. It's gonna flex different on one side than the other. So I always recommend making sure that the flange is either in on both sides or out on both sides. Your center carrier, it has to go on the inside here because your rear gear goes there, so it can't go the other way. We're going to put them in. That's kind of how Gary starts his chassis, and that's what we're going to do. So first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and get these two put into the chassis, bolted in, and as square as I can get them vertically with the chassis. I'm going to get that done, and then I'll show you guys how I go about truing the axle in. Thank you. we have the two, back you guys up a touch. We have the two carriers bolted in. Like I said, they're both middle setting. I've already kind of checked with the digital caliper how they sit in here, and the holes are fairly even. They did a good job welding it, so it's fairly straight already. I have both pinch bolts for the bearings. Both pinch bolts are loose. Now, keep in mind these bearings fit very tight in these cassettes. So it's not like you gotta worry about this thing falling out here when you're trying to set this up. I mean, it takes a lot of effort to move this thing. So what I'll do is I'll take the axle. It's always a good idea to take your axle and wipe this thing down, especially if it's a used axle. I'll wipe it down, I'll even take a file, and there'll be little burrs where the set screws set in the axle. Take a file and clean those up so that you don't have to fight this thing. You know, if you gotta beat this axle in and out with a hammer, you know, that's a problem. Either the axle needs to be cleaned, the bearing needs to be cleaned, something, but this thing should slide in and out fairly effortlessly. So when we're doing this, we don't care about the brake caliper, we don't care about the rotor, we're gonna be putting this thing in and out, just getting the bearings set first. So the first thing you're gonna do, put this thing through. It doesn't really matter which way you start. I always start from the engine side, but it's personal preference. So what we're looking for is, if you look here, if you look here on this little bit, move you down. So if you look here on the end of the axle, you can see that the bearings have a little bit of droop in them. So the bearing has this play to it, up and down and left and right, okay? So what I'm always looking for is that the bearing, we're in the center of the slop. You know, I want the bearing to run as free as possible. So I want, when this thing's at full droop, you can kind of see down here at full droop that it is almost even with the outside of the bearing. If I lift up on it, it's close to the same. Like I'm pretty happy with that. Now forwards and backwards, you know, is it even there? You know, so it actually comes a little bit farther back than it does forward. You know, so even in the center, it's not exactly running true. It's close, but if you're not exactly right, if you take it and just hit the axle, like I said, it moves the bearing on the other side. So like now you can see how far forward this axle goes, and see it won't come back all the way. So now we moved it too far. And you kind of just got to sit here and play with it until you get it to be just perfect. And it definitely takes some patience, but I promise you in the end, it makes a difference. Okay, so with the bearing centered now, I mean, it's like seamless. It fits perfect, you know, and you can tell that the bearings just spin super free. So now what that's done is this side of the bearing now is done. This carrier is complete, it's centered, and now I'm gonna take an Allen wrench, I'm gonna lock this set screw down. Okay, now what we're gonna do is we're gonna take the axle out and we're gonna go from the other side now. So this bearing is tight, this bearing's pinch bolt is still loose. So we're gonna pull the axle back out. Okay, now we're gonna start from the other side. So we're gonna slide the axle in this side. We're gonna do the same thing we did on the other side. So you can see here, if you look really closely here, let's see, can you see? You can see how low the axle is on this side. So the axle sits way down, and if you lift up on it, it barely even goes even with the inside of the bearing. So like if I put that through there, is that gonna work? Certainly, it's gonna work just fine. But is this other bearing gonna run perfectly true in the center of the race? No, it's always gonna have a little bit of a bind to it. So now we're gonna send it to the other side, lift up on it. Okay, so up and down, that's pretty even. Now forwards and backwards. Forwards and backwards, this side is good. So now we're gonna slide it through. Okay, so now this bearing over here is done. So now I'm gonna tighten this side up. Okay. So those two bearings are done. You can see just how easy the axle moves in here, how nice it spins. I mean, that is what we're looking for. Okay. So now we're gonna slide this axle back. Okay, now we're gonna take our third bearing, all right? We're gonna put our third bearing in here. Same thing, we're gonna put a couple bolts in it. Now, the third bearing on this chassis and the third bearing on a lot of the chassis, this third bearing does not have the same pre-drilled holes that the outside has. This inside one just has slots. Because all this bearing is for is a support, because the engine is pulling and trying to twist the axle. And there's a lot you can do with this bearing. You know, there are times where we'll leave these bolts loose so that this bearing can float. There's times we'll have them tight. You know, there's times we'll run grub screws, you know, set screws in this third one. And most of the time, I don't even run set screws in here. All this is supporting, but we don't want it to bind the axle. So the outside bearings, we're gonna run the set screws. You have to. You don't want the axle moving left and right in the chassis. All right, so I'm gonna put four bolts in this one here. Okay, so I do not want this bearing to be tight. I want these moved up here enough. But this thing's not flopping all over the place. But we know that this axle is true in the frame. We know that the two outside bearings, it sits perfectly in. So all we care about now is that this axle slides true to this bearing. So this one was already pretty close. I kind of already played with it earlier. But you should be able to slide it. It should go through all three bearings, and it should be that free. I mean, this thing should be just effortless. You know, obviously if you have a used cart and a used axle and everything has kind of got some corrosion on it, it might not be as free, but it's imperative that you take time, clean the axle up, you know, clean the inside of the bearings. Even if you wipe the axle down with like some WD-40, it makes this process a lot easier on a used axle. Once you get to this point, and you can see that the axle is just spins free, feels perfect. I mean, it should have little to no drag. Go ahead and tighten the pinch bolt on the third bearing. Okay, so now that that is all done, we're gonna go ahead and I'm gonna assemble the brake caliper. I'm gonna assemble the rear rotor and all of the pieces. I have to run a cog pulley back here for the water pump. I'm gonna get all that stuff slid on and get the axle put back in, get keyways put in, get all that set. And then I'm gonna go through and tighten this third bearing. I'm not gonna tighten this third bearing up until everything's in, and I'm gonna measure from the outside of the bearing carrier to the outside of the axle on each side, make sure the axle is perfectly centered between the two. Once all that's done, I'll go ahead and put these grub screw or set screws in these outside bearings and tighten them down. They don't need to be so tight that they're like bending the axle. Like some people tighten them so much that it's actually putting dents in the axle, but they need to be tight enough that they bite into the material and they stop the axle from moving left to right. Like I said, I do not run set screws in this third bearing. There are weird times where maybe I would, but in general, I never do. And I'm gonna start off with this third bearing tight, but I'm not gonna tighten it until everything's set. As you're assembling this and you're putting the axle in, keep verifying that everything moves free. If you get to a point where the axle doesn't spin free, it's likely that whatever the last thing was you did is binding it up. You definitely don't want to have gone through all this work and then have one thing that's binding the chassis up. So, you know, take your time assembling it, make sure everything's clean, you know, make sure everything is perfect. When you put the brake caliper on here and you got the rotor set on the axle, you know, make sure the rotor is exactly centered in the brake caliper. Make sure it's not sitting to one side or the other, you know, so the pads are, you know, interacting and they're not centered, you know. Be very meticulous about that stuff and it pays off in the end. So I'm gonna go ahead and get this all assembled and I'll talk about it a little bit here at the end when I'm all done, and then we'll end this video here. And then I will start up another video setting the seat and doing the alignment. I mean, we have a lot of stuff to do to this in the next 2 weeks to make it perfect. And that's what it needs to be. It needs to be perfect. So, yeah, let me get this assembled and I'll be back with you guys here shortly. All right, we're back. What seemingly took no time for you took quite a bit of time. Brings me to one more point that's important. When you're putting this together for its final assembly, don't get ahead of yourself, forget to put pieces on. Like if you're running an external water pump, you know, TM175 or a rock engine, you know, you have an external water pump, you have to have some kind of belt on it. If I had a dollar for every time I put an axle in and didn't put the belt on, you know, I'd have more than a handful of dollars. So make sure that you do that. Make sure you don't forget to put that on your brake rotor, stuff like that. Don't forget all your pieces. I got everything assembled. Everything is tight. Except for this pulley here, just because I want you guys to be able to see, you know, just how smooth it still spins. That's with the brake rotor on, everything. I mean, it has, you know, very minimal, if any, drag. Obviously, it'll have some once I get this tight because the water pump has no water in it. But I also have an extra water pump belt zip tied to the axle right here. Whether you run a Gilmer style cog belt or you run a rubber band style belt, it's always a good idea to have an extra set zip tied or taped to the axle. Unfortunately, it looks like crap, which annoys me, but it's a big deal. If you ruin a belt or you lose a belt or break one, whatever, not having to pull your axle out at the track in a rush, because you know it always happens at the absolute worst case, worst time. So having an extra one on here, super helpful. So make sure you guys put an extra belt or rubber band on the axle. Other than that, got the hubs put on, nothing set for width. We'll talk about that when we do setup and alignment, but everything else is done. The rear brake rotor, also keep in mind on every kart that I've ever seen, the rear brake rotor is directional. The marks on the face of the rotor mean nothing. The vanes in the center need to be going so that there's pulling air from the middle and they're blowing air out. You do not want the outside scooping air, that's backwards. So make sure the rotor is put on the correct direction. I've seen a handful of karts with them on backwards. That's definitely not helping you. Same thing goes for the front. Other than that, I got the rotor nice and centered in between the caliper, and that just makes sure you don't have a ton of drag on the pads. And all the set screws are tight and everything's still, you know, you should be able to spin everything as nice as you could with just the axle in. So we're gonna mark this one off the list. I'm gonna go ahead and kind of get set up for the next video. It'll probably be a seat install video. That's a pretty important one, you know, questionably one of the most important things. So that'll be probably the next thing on our list, and then we'll just head from there. So thank you for tuning in. This has been, I enjoy showing people the way that I do things. I think it helps people. I want everyone to go out and have a successful weekend. Like I said earlier in the video, I hate seeing people lose races for mechanical problems, and I hate just seeing carts that are, you know, just cobbled together and really just, you know, hurting performance. It bothers me. So if I can help somebody, you know, if I can help one person go a tenth faster or not lose a race, then we're heading in the right direction. So thank you for watching. Be looking out for part two. I'm going to try to keep the videos coming pretty quick since I'm leaving here in a couple weeks for Vegas. I'm going to be busy in the garage. So I'll have videos coming out. Let me know if you guys have something specific that you want to see. Put it in the comments and I'll try to make sure that it's going to happen. And we'll go from there. So thanks again, and we'll talk to you guys soon.